So this session relates to chapter 6, which is the only chapter that you don't yet have and will be forthcoming. But most of the material of chapter 6 is at least introduced and touched on in these slides. And they relate to normative or sort of value judgment choices in measurement design. And it sounds perhaps quite off-putting or quite academic, but as you'll see, these are actually where we start to confront the decisions of how do you make a measure and how do you design it. I begin with a quote that I like a lot by Frank Cowell, who observes, he was working on inequality measurement, but the same observation holds for poverty measurement, that the modern field of inequality or poverty measurement grew out of the intelligent application of quantitative methods to imperfect data in the hope of illuminating important social issues. So what we're doing is we're using very important imperfect data. We're trying to look at an important social issue, which is poverty. And doing so is not straightforward. It's not something you can take off the peg. It does require thought and thoughtfulness, or what he calls intelligent application of the methods that we have of quantitative measurement and analysis. So in a sense, what we're going to be probing a little bit more is how do we do that in the case of multidimensional poverty measurement. And what you will do is rapidly when you break into working groups, you will be going through the very same eight choices that I'm presenting today and applying them in the next week. So we begin again with diversity, which shouldn't be a surprise. And we begin by recognizing that people are diverse in many different ways, as we've discussed, by age and gender and ethnicity and nationality, location, religion, relationships, abilities, personalities, occupation, hobbies, interests, and values. So we have a gamut of ways in which people are diverse, as Sen has repeatedly stressed in developing the capability approach. And what does a poverty measure seek to do? It seeks to identify legitimate, accurate, and policy-relevant comparisons across people. Who is poor and who is non-poor, and how poor are the poor people? And it does so recognizing and respecting the diversity of people. And poverty measures also seek to do this using very imperfect data. Data that have non-sampling measurement errors, that have sampling problems or overlooked populations, and other limitations. And so the task of poverty measurement is not straightforward because the nature of the task, what is the poverty of a baby? What is the poverty of a person who a few years ago was very wealthy and then has gotten laid off of their job? So the point on diversity we've already covered sufficiently. But what we're focusing now is on making these different normative choices. And so I think it's useful, and throughout this class I'll be presenting different definitions of terms. So normative choices are nothing more than value judgments or reasoned judgments or arguments. And they are linked, they link the measurement design back to poor people. Does this actually reflect poverty in any way that's legitimate in society and among poor communities? And then they link it forward to policy, to the different actors that are trying to fight poverty and reduce it. And so in a sense, these choices act as communication channels between multiple stakeholders who have different ideas of what poverty is. And all poverty measures, whether they are unidimensional or multidimensional, income or consumption, they require normative choices, explicitly or implicitly. Even if, as we saw yesterday, they are designed using PCA, we saw all of the normative choices that you have to make in actually deciding how to configure your particular application of principal components analysis. And for many people, this fact of having to make value judgments or even talk about it makes us uncomfortable because that's not what we're trained to do. were trained to do quantitative techniques. And yet Sen, from the early days, and this is from Inequality Reexamined, has stressed that the need, for example, for the selection and discrimination among functionings, if that's what we are using to measure, is neither an embarrassment nor a unique difficulty for the conceptualization of functionings and capabilities. Schumann talked about the need to set a monetary poverty line, or the need to bring together different consumption items using prices or imputing prices, the need to compare across regions where the price vectors vary. So there are a lot of decisions that are made no matter what kind of measuring you are doing. Do sugary drinks go in your food poverty basket or not if the poor people consume them? So I'm going to talk about, very briefly, the high-level normative decisions, and then the rest of the class will focus on the 8 core choices that are made when you design a multidimensional poverty measure. What I want to recognize is that, in a sense, you, because many of you will be designing measures, are going to pull together different kinds of arguments from different kinds of people. You may have either participatory groups themselves, or people have conducted participatory studies coming and telling you about the different values that have arisen in poor communities from those studies. You may yourself do empirical assessments about redundancy, associations between indicators. You may look at data quality. You may do robustness tests. And your final choices will be affected clearly by your empirical assessments. There may be experts, poverty experts who have worked for 30 years in the field who come and tell you their views. There may be a moment, a window of opportunity, because somebody is about to roll out a planned intervention or they're about to roll out a survey. And if you can catch the moment, then this work will be institutionalized for the next 5 years. And then there are practicalities. You want to do something and the variable doesn't exist in the survey. Budgets get cut or end of the year money comes in. There's a human resource, the South African who left Stats SA. There's authority or political will. Somebody has made it their mission. Some political leader has made it their mission to release a multidimensional poverty by a given date. And there's political feasibility. How do negotiations across political parties or actors happen? And then there will be people who say, but this is not constitutional. Or they'll say, our constitution says this about poverty and it's mandatory and compulsory to respect these basic rights. So at one level, normative reasoning is still used to bring the different insights that come from all these sources together and find options that are not worse than any other options and clarify the benefits and the disbenefits of different courses of action. And that sounds messy and complex, and I mentioned in the morning the 1997 paper by Sen on using these different kinds of arguments to rule out options that are dominated by others and to clarify the benefits of some. So I just wanted to name that. We're not going to do that otherwise, but I'll give you some situations. For example, you might be asked, should we release a measure now or not? And then you have to think, well, should we release it now? It's imperfect. You know, I haven't had the time to do this. The survey that we can use doesn't have this variable in it. And yet there's this political window of opportunity that maybe argues I should go right now, but what if it's not a good enough measure, then maybe people will lose faith in this possibility, maybe I should wait. So there are these kinds of difficult choices, but normative reasoning helps us to try to clarify the arguments and know why we're taking a course of action. Enough said, we'll move on. I am going to skip this because I think there's a lot to go through, but I put this slide in so that you would, when you're going through these later, think about how these different kinds of insights might come to life in the contexts in which you are working or constructing measures. I'll give you one kind of trade-off that is perhaps the most common trade-off that all of us will face. And it's the trade-off between relevance and usability. And this is a very long quote from Amartya Sen, Living Standards, where he was speaking in that context about measures of living standards. And I think he puts it very well, that a measure must, first of all, to somehow do justice to the motivation that makes us interested in measuring multidimensional poverty in the first place, or living standards. And yet, while it has to be rich, it also has to be practical. So it has to be usable for actual assessments, given the constraints that we're working under. And he points out that we always have this tension. We want to enrich our measures to include empowerment, or to include security, or to include gender. And yet we may not be able to because of the different constraints. And relevance wants us to be ambitious. Usability urges restraint. Relevance wants to really reflect the complexity of poverty and the different definitions in the field. And usability says, we have to be as simple as possible so the journalists understand. And so he says, this is, of course, a very common conflict in economics. And while we have to face it squarely, we must not make heavy weather of it. So it's just to say, this is part of the territory we're in if we're working on measurement. It's a territory of compromise. This should be 8. Because 5 comes twice. This was before lunch. So there are 8 choices when you design a measure. First, what is the purpose of the measure? Second, in what space do you want to measure poverty, resources, functionings and capabilities, or utility? Third, who are you going to identify as poor? A person, a household, a region? Fourth, what dimensions are you going to use to evaluate poverty? Fifth, what are the indicators, the columns in your matrix, that you are going to put quantitative numbers behind? Sixth, how much is enough not to be deprived in each indicator? Seventh, what is the relative value of different deprivations in comparison one to another? And eighth, what is the share of deprivations you must experience in order to be identified as poor? So if you're constructing an AF methodology as you did yesterday, all of those choices were made. Dimensions were synonymous with indicators yesterday, but you had 4 indicators. You had the cutoffs, you had equal weights, and you played with poverty cutoffs. Those 8 choices are going to be the focus of today. But alongside, I want to mention other things that are often forgotten when we're designing a new measure, but are essential for it. One is, what is the process of developing it? We can do it on our computers, as you will do, very quickly. But what is the public process? What kinds of deliberative or public consultations, participatory exercises, expert groups need to be set up? And who should be engaged in developing the measure? What is the legal or institutional basis of the measure? How is it going to endure? Is it going to be passed by Parliament? Is it going to build on a law? You'll see some examples in the national studies after the tea break of those legal and institutional bases. And then a point Angus Deaton often stresses, who has the authority to update the measure? Because a measure made once that's repeated every time new data come in will, after some years, need to be revised. Being very clear who has the authority to revise the survey, to revise the methodology, and when it should be updated. Is it the next time or is it after a decade? Those are also key. And then also thinking through the incentives that the measure provides. It may provide incentives for different groups to have their work recognized within government, but it also may provide unusual incentives, or it may lack incentives. For example, somebody looking at the global MPI, who is a minister of nutrition in South Asia, pointed out that the global MPI doesn't reflect micronutrients, but her government had just invested a great deal in providing micronutrients. this measure provided no incentive to recognize or to deliver those, and so it was a lack in that example. And the last is political considerations. None of us perhaps are good at these, but we all have to navigate them somehow. And we'll have another class on communication for policy next week. So I just mentioned these now because they are important to think of as you're putting something into place, and to talk with different colleagues about and ponder. It seems like quite a big task to do all of these choices, to do normative choices. There's no style of command to do this. And also it requires negotiation and group work. So what I will do is simply try to share the available resources on each step and the considerations. And so as you are going through this, you can justify what you have done. Because I can guarantee you that when you release your measure, the most common question you will get is, why didn't you put in my favorite indicator? And you'll have to explain. Or, why don't you decompose by gender? Or, you know, so these questions will come up. And so in a sense, what you will do when you are writing your report is justify every decision that you make. And I'll give you one example. Very recently, I was at a meeting looking at a proposed measure for a number of countries, and they had chosen the indicators, they had done all of these normative choices, and they presented them. And the people were very dissatisfied, the expert group that was looking at this measure, and they were dissatisfied not with the results, but with the fact that they hadn't said, why are you choosing this deprivation cutoff? Why are you leaving out this dimension? Why are you using these data sources? So even though it may seem a bit soft, actually writing up in one paragraph each, so eight paragraphs, each of these choices, at least, is quite important to structuring your report. And hopefully there are some examples that you have seen or that we can share on ways of writing these up. I still can't count. So the first of the eight choices is the purpose, and it guides, in a sense, everything that follows. So I'm going to spend a bit more time on it and give you an example to write up of how to justify a purpose. This is for your library, not for you to look at now, but this is the definition of those eight things. The purpose. So the Stiglitz-Sanfitusi Commission described the purposes at this. Again, they were talking about quality of life, but it's relevant when we measure poverty. The range of features to be considered will depend on the purpose of the exercise, which we've just said. And the purpose, in a sense, does reflect the context in which a measure is being developed. So usually, a measure is developed for an impact evaluation or for monitoring a particular program or for monitoring national poverty over time. So it may have a dynamic purpose to track trends over time for one of several different purposes. It may be to look at a particular delineated geographic region or sector or time period of interest. It may be for a particular user group, a particular ministry, a NGO charged with delivering a particular set of outcomes. And what are the key comparisons? Are they between men and women? Are they between household sizes, age groups of children, urban-rural groups, or geographic regions, or social groups? So the most common purposes for multidimensional poverty measures are either basically to be a national poverty measure, which, like an income poverty measure, shows the level, in the case of multidimensional poverty, the composition and the trends of poverty over time, and can be decomposed by the relevant groups. Other measures, as I said, are program specific and monitor or evaluate the impact of certain activities. And then measures may also be used for particular comparisons and for targeting the poorest, either using geographic targeting or household or individual targeting if census data are available. These different purposes, of course, govern how often in a measure is repeated and the different, the kind of survey, what its representativeness and design needs to be, and in a sense, who is included in the survey. So here's an example of how you might frame a purpose and write it down. The National Poverty Measure aims to assess the population-wide, so that's all citizens in society, progress in capability, poverty reduction, so there's your choice of space, capability, poverty reduction, every 2 years, the periodicity of your survey, across states, the level of disaggregation you require, rural-urban regions, ethnic and religious groups. So your survey has to be representative by these groups in ways that are regarded as legitimate and accurate by the citizenry. So you need to have some input about people's ideas of poverty and their response to at least pilot results. The measure shall be disseminated across these different places and communicated widely to citizen and groups. So that has to do with how the measure is communicated, how it's understood, whether you use graphics or tables, whether you use fancy equations. And then the purpose may also include a statement of data and of governance. For example, the measure may use a particular survey, in this case a newly designed survey to be fielded every 2 years. Who fields it? The NSB has the authority to implement the survey, construct the measure, and release it as an official statistic. So it names the lead institution. And the NSB has the authority to update the methodology, and it's expected to happen roughly once per decade. And the changes in the methodology are to be approved by a cross-institutional working group and involving also the Statistical Advisory Council. So here's an example, just a mock-up, of the kinds of questions that you might want to answer in your sample purpose of your measure. So the periodicity, who it covers, the survey disaggregation, how you're communicating it, and the institutions that are constructing it. And when you have done that well, then a lot of the choices will follow naturally from it. And you can go back and say, oh yes, choice of space, we already decided that, that's capabilities. But all of the 8 choices that I'll name are iterative. What that means is that they may need to be repeated and reconsidered as the process goes on. You may say the space of capability, but your newly designed survey has 0 capability indicators. So you have to reconsider that aspect of your purpose, naturally. So for example, a measure that's designed to monitor progress towards a national development plan may systematically exclude public debate. And people may raise such concerns about this that either that requires justification or that is changed over time. Or a measure designed to document a given set of human rights from the Universal Declaration may ignore cultural values. And so maybe that needs to be reconsidered justified why you need contextual or comparable measures. So there are some other examples. Just because you say it is the purpose doesn't mean that other people are going to agree with you, and they may want to change the purpose. But having that stated explicitly sets out what you aim to do, and then it engenders, in a sense, constructive public debate about your measure. So, a bit of a pause to wake you back up. Think of a concrete situation. We're not going to go through these now. We'll go through them a little bit later. But think of one concrete situation in which you have developed a measure. And if you haven't yet done that, something you might develop. What was the purpose? And what were the constraints of data or cost or time or political objectives that you operated under? So I'm going to give you 5 minutes to do that.
Okay, thank you. Basically, I've been working with designing measures most of my work life where, you know, I was responsible for adjusting sample weights.
Okay. So just give us one example.
Sample weights, let's say. So that the survey weights are representative of the national population in such a way that bias and undercount are accounted for. So sometimes you'll find that the weight, I have to make sure that the weight can estimate population, smaller population groups. Like you find that we've got Indians, which are the minority groups in the in the country. But if I'm not careful, you may find that when you do estimates, this population group is underestimated, you know, and their characteristics, you know, cannot correctly be, you know, explained. So, and it was a national indicator that I had to deal with. So I had to make sure that, you know, it can stand political challenges, you know, in terms of why the figures are like this and are not the way we know the country to be, you know.
Thank you.
I don't know if that's a relevant example of an indicator.
Yeah. I think it's a relevant example of a concrete situation. I think in terms of a purpose statement, you would want to know, basically the purpose was presumably to compare different groups within the population, including the Indian population. And so that might be part of the purpose. Let's hear one more, Francisco. You need both of them.
Both?
Yeah, because one of them's for him and one of them's for us.
Okay, two thank fists. You. Well, in Chile, this is the situation now. We participate with three institutions, ECLAC, the Minister of Development, Social Development, and the National Institute of Statistics. And the objective is first change the poverty line. We measure by the calories, so
the income
approach. But the difficulty is that there is not clear what is the institute which must measure this line, and the other difficulty is how compare, for example, first. Which dimension must to use from the data that is the and how compare, for example, in 10 years more when we should change the indicators, because in my country it's very important the comparison, and I don't know why, but why do you choose this dimension and in 10 years more why measure the same dimension. So for us is very, it's not clear now.
Yeah.
How across this difficult.
Okay. So I think we'll leave it at that, but it's just to start to think about the purposes, and we'll come back to it later today. So the purpose, you have to keep it in mind as you go through the remaining choices. So the second choice is the choice of space that we basically already covered. But I put a few nuances in it because it's not so simple as resources and functionings and utility, because some measures rightly cover access to services and some cover enjoying services or social protection. But those are not necessarily the same as functionings and need to be checked. So just to run through one example, if you're thinking of the choice of space and you want to focus on resources, it might be money for healthcare. I could pay to go and get treated for an ailment. Or it might be access to services. I have access to a health clinic. It is in my community. or I have services. I enjoy social protection. I go to the health clinic. It's open. There's a health worker there, and the pharmacy has supplies. Or it might be functionings and capabilities. I enjoy good health. Or it might be subjective utility. I'm happy with my health status. So as we said earlier, there's no right answer, but the choice depends on the purpose. So if you are a school and you're trying to increase the access to education without consideration for quality, you would use a different kind of measure than if your focus was really improving the quality and the educational achievements of existing school-going children. The third step is the choice of the unit of identification or analysis. What is that? The unit of identification is who is identified as poor or non-poor. Whose poverty status do we determine by applying the poverty cutoff? So, for example, it could be the person. And if it's the person, it could be everybody in society. It could be all children up to the age of 15. It could be all women, elderly people above the age of 60, workers, political leaders. It could also be a different unit like the household, all household members, where the household has to be defined. Is it de facto? Is it de jure? Is it the people who sleep there generally or the people who slept there last night? Is it people who eat together? So what is your definition of household? It could be an institution, a school, or a clinic. If you're the Minister of Education, you really want a multidimensional measure of school achievements, not of individual achievements, perhaps. Or it might be a geographic region, a village, or a data zone, or a district. Maybe if you were doing corruption. probably not. So the choice of unit of analysis, as I said, is often constrained by data, but it does also depend on the purpose. The unit of analysis is how data are reported. So as the unit of identification refers to who's identified as poor, but you could identify at the village level and yet talk about the percentage of people. So you could analyze, you could population weight each village and talk about the percentage of people who are poor. And similarly, you could identify at the household level as you did yesterday, but you might want to weight up by the number of members of the household so that H would be a population headcount ratio. So those are the terms, unit of identification and analysis. And in practice, it depends what sampling weights you use when you report your results. So why would you use, how do you choose? Clearly, there are constraints, what you have in terms of data and your purpose. A person-based measure is best, it's essential if you want to decompose by gender or by age. If you want to look within the household, you need a person-based measure. If you have a person-based measure, like a child poverty measure, let's say you want to include clean water, then you are going to allocate to every child in that household equally whether or not they have clean water. If you include income of the household in a child poverty measure, then you might also allocate to each child the average income status of that household or whether or not that household is income poor. But of course, there are problems in allocating that because all children may not equally benefit from household income. So there are some considerations, but there are clear strengths. The household is the most common unit of analysis in multi-topic household surveys, and it's the one used in the global MPI presented yesterday. But it requires combining, as you saw, individual level data, if you have it, for education, for health indicators, for employment indicators. You would have to combine the achievements of different household members. And we'll be talking about different ways of doing that, using an average, using whether anybody has achieved this or whether anybody lacks this. And then you could also do a subgroup measure. The most common are perhaps child poverty measures. And that's not uncomplicated because babies who don't go to school have different indicators that pertain to them than school-going children, and children in puberty have different indicators again. So children are quite complicated. Now, if you are going to use a school, for example, you might have the teacher-student ratios as an indicator. You might have the supervision. You might have the training and qualifications of the teachers. You might have whether they have good facilities of a building and hygiene. You might have the textbooks. You might have the achievement scores of the schools, of the students on average that come out of that institution. So you might have a number of different indicators, but you would basically aggregate everything together for that institution and then weight it by the number of students attending. But this kind of approach can be useful in sectoral policies. And then, of course, if your data are administrative and relevant at the district level and you need to combine data sources, then you could have a district-level poverty measure, grabbing, you know, one indicator from this data source and another from another. If you do this at the national level, it becomes a marginal measure that we discussed yesterday does not reflect in any meaningful way the joint distribution of deprivations. So that's the choice of unit of identification and analysis. As I said, often you're data constrained. The most common are either individual, which, for example, we used in the European EU SILC measure, or household in the global MPI. Now we move to a different terrain, which is now starting to move towards the content of the measure, which is the choice of dimensions. I already gave the Sen's quote on, you know, the need for selection not being an embarrassment. But he also points out that, you know, all measures, all normative evaluations will need to, in a sense, figure out what are the relevant capabilities or the relevant dimensions to go into them. Now, what is a dimension and what is an indicator? I start with the bottom of this PowerPoint, which is called a confusion prevention note. The confusion prevention note tells you that we changed our own definition, so please don't let us confuse you. In this presentation, I use the same terms that Adriana used yesterday. So dimensions refer to conceptual categories of indicators for ease of communication. I should have added weighting and interpretation of results. In the global MPI, there were three dimensions: health, education, and living standards. By indicators, we mean the D variables that appear in the columns of the achievement and deprivation matrices and are used to construct the deprivation scores and measure poverty quantitatively. There were 10 indicators in the global MPI. So that's the language that I'm using. Dimensions are categories. They are not quantitative, but often, in fact, in all existing national measures to date, the dimensions are equally weighted. So they are chosen for the convenience of communication. So again, a little pause. Please, just very quickly, you have 1 minute to do this, write three dimensions, not lots, but just three dimensions you've used and what indicators and deprivation cutoffs you've used in a multidimensional poverty you've made, or if you haven't done that, then one you know about. I see that at least some people have finished. So does somebody want to share their response? Yep, Udoy. Briefly.
Yeah, in the last survey we did, we used the health domain. Mm-hmm. And the indicators we used the self-reported health status, one. Then healthy days, the second indicator. Then disability, mm-hmm. third indicator. And the fourth one is satisfaction with healthcare services, the four indicators.
Very good.
But they have sub-indicators as well.
Yeah. Thank you. Keep this sheet of paper. We're going to come back to it. Please go ahead.
The last survey we did, we looked at gender, realizing that poverty, generally the notion is, the feeling is that poverty has a female face in our society. So we really looked at gender parity in primary and secondary education. We also look at number of women in political positions and senior public positions. On the health also, we looked at one of the indicators we used was the number of children stunting and wasting. We also, under the income and expenditure area, we looked at per capita consumption using dollar per person per day. Yeah, okay.
Okay, thank you so much. So those are marginal, those are presumably national measures you then considered and combined. So it's not micro level data, but it's a very clear structure of having three dimensions, gender, health, and economic well-being. And a clear set of indicators below them. And implicit deprivation cutoffs, stunting is two standard deviations below the Z score for the reference population. So how do we choose dimensions in the case of a multidimensional poverty measure? We've heard gender, health, and income, or economic well-being. We've heard a health-based measure with different dimensions of health. The first input is always the data constraint. It will come back again and again. But there are three others that often are used to justify the choice of dimensions. First of all, when we use existing data, it can be useful, and Ingrid Robbins clarifies it can be useful for many reasons and really urges us to name in our papers the dimensions we wanted to include but could not for a lack of data. For example, in the global MPI, we wanted to include personal security from physical violence, and we wanted to include work. But the household surveys do not include those variables plus health, education, and living standards. By naming the missing dimensions of poverty data again and again, we can try to change the conventions of survey design, and so that the missing dimensions come into survey design. And we'll be having a class on this next week because OFI regularly tries to look at the missing dimensions of poverty data, including empowerment also, and shame and humiliation and isolation. But beyond that, often the choice of dimensions is justified by deliberative participatory processes. So these could be a lot of focus groups. It could be a distillation of PRA exercises. It could be a Voices of the Poor exercise. It could be we started on Monday with a Million Voices, the World We Want work. But in a sense, these dimensions could reflect the outcomes of ongoing, not just one of, but ongoing and legitimate in the sense of including the relevant populations and not systematically excluding some of them, that elicit the values and perspectives of different stakeholders. And there are different ways in practice. For example, one of the things that worked very well in El Salvador was they set up a round table that had many different stakeholders who usually didn't meet together, from academic experts to trade unions to NGOs to government actors. And it was this very diverse roundtable, which helped to bring the perspectives of different groups together. And in others, they have more sets of consultations and or collaborations with different institutions.
Sabina,
yeah?
For countries like mine, we have many issues that arise as people's concern. So the bigger difficulty, even in the round tables, is to make sure that we manage to get a kind of a 4, 5, or 6 priorities we can consider for poverty measurement.
Yeah.
Maybe I should ask what is the best way, because we can say, we can make a list, like put education, health, but I still question, because it feels as if I'm already imposing the direction of the indicators I want to use. But also, if I leave it open, then everything will come. The shopping list will be really long, and I will not be able to find the priorities. So what would be the best way of doing so?
There are different, it's a very, very good question. And there are different ways of going forward. One is, in a sense, a voting method, where you see how many people, like the Million Voices, basically has people to vote on a list, and the one that got the one dimensions that got the most votes won, in a sense. That's also what they did, as we will see, in the Socially Perceived Necessities Survey in South Africa, when it was used to identify deprivations that were of interest. Another way is, in a sense, which I think more of, is to try to explain the exercise to the participants. And so they are charged, instead of you are charged, you give your problem to them. And you say, there are so many problems. You know, we need to build a cemetery. We need to improve our road. We need to supervise our teachers better. We need, but what I need from you is I need 4 or 5 things. And ask, in a sense, devolve that discussion. And then see the 4 or 5 things that come up in different exercises. What's very difficult is that often these participatory exercises come up with ordinal ranks, but you don't know the strength of the different ones. A second is to use an existing document which already has some kind of degree of legitimacy. So Mexico used a law and some constitutional promises. Colombia used its national development plan. The global MPI built on the Millennium Development Goals and the dimensions built on the Human Poverty Index and the Human Development Index. But there, you also might want to use other documents that already have some kind of legitimacy and say, look, we are reflecting the goals that have been set here. And the third is, very often people will bring in theories. Martha Nussbaum came up with a list of 10 central human capabilities. And so when Wolf and DeChalet were looking at disadvantage, they looked at her 10 indicators. There's a study of exclusion in Britain, and they used her 10 central capabilities. So often, these, in this case, dimensions use a pre-existing list that is based on some theory. And there are many different theories that it could be based on. Social exclusion, human rights, livelihood, social cohesion, capability, basic needs, and so on. Others, for example, Stiglitz and Fitoussi identify 8 dimensions of quality of life. I've done some exercise of consolidating or synthesizing existing lists of well-being and of poverty. And Francis Stewart has similarly done that. So there might be these kinds of theories that are used to justify or to partly justify the choice of dimensions. Usually, more than one justification is given. So usually, maybe it's a national development plan, and it also coheres with the outcome of a youth summit that was held last year or whatever. So there might be several justifications, for example, for the dimensions used in a national measure. There might have been a recent set of exercises. There might be national commitment to the Millennium Development Goals. And then, of course, the data sets will come in. One thing I should signal now is that because dimensions don't enter the data set, as I mentioned, to date, they are often equally weighted. And actually, Tony Atkinson and colleagues, Eric Marlier et al., in the context of Europe, as Europe was moving to national plans for poverty and an open method of coordination of data, they suggested actually choosing the dimensions such that equal weights made sense. And this is for policy purposes. It has nothing to do with techniques. So they wrote that the interpretation of a set of indicators or dimensions is greatly eased where the individual components have degrees of importance, i.e. weights, that while not necessarily exactly equal, are not grossly different. So I just raise this again to reinforce that these dimensions, these choices are iterative and not one-off. And I already mentioned Ingrid Robbins says, please write up your justification. So when you write up your justification for your dimensions in your report or make your slide for next Friday, then you might want to do it using these suggestions. Now, just relax. Here's an example. In Colombia's national MPI that Anna will present after tea, there were 5 dimensions and 15 indicators. And the 5 dimensions and the indicators and the cutoffs actually drew on their national development plan. Mexico had 2 major dimensions, economic well-being and social rights, and they were equally weighted. And within the social rights, there were 6 rights defined, and these were equally weighted. These dimensions were named in the general law of social development. And so that was, in a sense, their justification primarily, although they could also be justified perhaps in other ways. And Gisela will present this after tea. So this may sound very woolly, very flabby, very soft. But the good news, Maimona, is that the number of dimensions people come up with actually are not so endless. In the chapter you've been circulated, there are 4 synthetic exercises on poverty, dimensions of poverty, which have come out of synthesizing measures of multidimensional poverty that are existing. I'll share with you a few lists of well-being. Starting with the voices of the poor, they identified 5 major dimensions of well-being and 12 minor dimensions. Bodily well-being, including health and survival. Material well-being, which is economic and work. Social well-being, relationships and dignity. Security from violence and also from risk. And psychological well-being, which included freedom of action and spiritual matters. The Stiglitz-Sen-Fitoussi Commission and the Bhutan Gross National Happiness Index have almost the same dimensions. Stiglitz-Sen-Fitoussi have 8 dimensions of quality of life, and Bhutan adds to those 1 on culture and spirituality. John Finnis, a philosopher who was here at Oxford and also in Notre Dame, has, I think, a very very elegant analytical framework for considering different dimensions of well-being, which I've used quite a bit in my own work, and he has 7 of those. And what you can see is, at a glance, there's not too much difference between them. They're wider than poverty measures because they refer to well-being, so they include inner peace or psychological well-being or emotional well-being or subjective measures of quality of life, which are not going to go into a poverty measure. But all of them include health, all of them include knowledge or education, all of them include an economic dimension. And then there are other aspects. And so you can draw on these resources, in a sense, and as I mentioned, we'll circulate others on poverty, to cross-check yourself and also to get ideas of things that you may have overlooked. So briefly, look just at the three dimensions, not at the indicators, but the dimensions you wrote down. How did you justify those in the exercise that you undertook, the three dimensions you wrote down last time we stopped? And given what I've just said, how might you want to justify them in terms of deliberative processes, in terms of a public consensus, or in terms of a theory? Does anybody want a woman, because we've had four men? Please? Yeah, you need your two microphones.
I would justify my dimensions and or indicators considering by the social and economic structure of the country. Mm-hmm. And the availability of data, of mm-hmm. course, not a public consensus. And I would give little importance to public consensus.
Okay. You have a social change activist
yes.
here. Very good. What are your three dimensions?
Health, mm-hmm. housing, mm-hmm. labor markets.
Very good. Thank you. So we're halfway through the content and more than halfway through the time. So, but there's some important material left to come on indicators, deprivation cutoffs, weights, and the poverty cutoff. So the good news is that indicators we are broadly covering tomorrow. We're going through a lot of the empirical and the technical and statistical considerations tomorrow. And so we will basically leave that to a different session because it's so rich, and also because it's perhaps less documented than the choice of dimensions, for example, where there's quite a large literature on that. The only thing I want to signal here is that your purpose is not only going to shape the choice of space, but also the kind of indicators that you will select. Atkinson and Eric Marlier have a 2010 book which is available full text online, and so we could email it if you would like. And they have a very good discussion of these five considerations of indicators, when to use stock, what are the kinds of measures, multidimensional measures that require stock versus flow indicators, static versus dynamic, inverse output or outcome indicators, subjective, objective, or relative or absolute. So if you're interested in thinking those things through, it's a very good reference. And the other normative aspect of indicators, in addition to all of the technical bits, is in a sense when you are communicating this measure back to the different stakeholders, you have to think of how to communicate it in a way that the indicators that you've chosen, perhaps, to reflect people's ideas of poverty sounds to them when you explain them back to them as though they do. And also so that the indicators seem relevant to those in positions of policy. For those who have been working in poverty for 30 years, they will want to know how you built on their work. And so your literature review, of course, will cite them. But key points are, can you really interpret? You need to be able to interpret the trend. And I'm going to give you an example. If you have subjective data, for example, on satisfaction with the government, I'll give you a real example from Bhutan's Gross National Happiness Survey. Governance is one of their nine dimensions of GNH. And they only became a democracy in 2008. And when the first survey was implemented, over 95% of people were delighted with their government. Of course, it was their first government. It was very new. But when you have a baseline of 95%, where do you go? So when you have a perceptual indicator, then to interpret the trend, you have to know how their frame of reference is changing. Remember the example we discussed of widows in Kerala versus Bihar? Kerala had the frame of reference of the cities in other countries, and Bihar had the frame of reference of their mothers. As things change, the frame of reference changes. And so a downward trend could be a good thing because it could reflect increasing aspirations and increasing knowledge by those people, or it could actually mean that governance had gotten worse. So you need to know if you can interpret the trends of change in indicators. And then obviously, are the data costs affordable? So these, I think, are quite obvious, but because we will not cover them in other sessions, I mentioned them here. So Atkinson and Marlier also give an example, which I will leave but not go through, of how to justify indicators. So they give an example of internationally comparable indicators of deprivation in the European context, and five criteria for justifying them. So I leave that to you, Andy. The Australian National Development Index is another very, very well articulated index with very clear criteria to justify its component indicators. Here's some examples which you'll go through in the afternoon. So Anna will share Colombia's MPI and how it's justified partly on technical grounds, the precision of the sample estimate, and then partly on these other grounds, that the indicators could be affected by public policy and that the data were available in the survey they had decided to use and that they were cohered with the literature and expert views that they had heard in their consultations preparing for the measure. So we're getting towards the end, and the next is deprivation cutoffs, which is your body mass index, the minimum years of schooling that you can, that you must attain not to be deprived. So the definition of a deprivation cutoff is there. They define the minimum level of achievement below which a person is deprived in each indicator. And what Bergugno and Chakravarti 2003 established, I think, is really important. And it's that it is this feature of having a deprivation cutoff for every indicator, which distinguishes multidimensional poverty measure from other measures that would use these same data and these same indicators. So really, when you think of what's distinct about a multidimensional measure that looks at joint disadvantage, it is having a deprivation cutoff for each indicator, as well as aggregating first across each unit of identification. And clearly, the deprivation cutoffs are going to matter empirically. If you think of the shape of the distribution, in income space, there's often this bulge around the poverty line, which is why there are robustness tests. But there are a few new things that you need to keep your eye out. You have identified five dimensions, and you've decided to equally weight them. But in one, you set a deprivation cutoff, like have every child aged 12 to 23 in your household been vaccinated, and 0.8% of the population are deprived, because many of them don't have a child of that age, or because nearly everybody is vaccinated. Another indicator is your health functioning is measured using the LSMS questions of the World Bank. Can you walk a kilometer? Can you lift a table? Can you bathe and dress yourself? And let's say that 20% of the population are deprived. So you have equal weights, you've set two deprivation cutoffs, and your uncensored headcounts are 20% and 0.8%. The effective weight on your health functionings is very much bigger than your effective weight on immunization or vaccination because the incidence is so low. So as you set the deprivation cutoffs, you may need to reevaluate your weights so that you understand, again, the interdependence between these. So you will always, you know, I think at the end of this week, you're going to present your normative choices. And you're going to want to, first thing, run your raw headcounts, uncensored headcounts, and then look at your weighting structure and see how it's going to change. Because you can start to get a feel for these things as you run them. And the final results may be sensitive to where you set the cutoffs. So how do you define or defend or justify your deprivation cutoffs when somebody says, well, why 5 years of schooling? Why not six? Why not eight? The answer in an international measure is, how do you do it? People have different years of primary schooling between 3 and 8 in different countries. But in a national measure, you can have much better justifications of deprivation cutoffs. So might be the purpose of the exercise, it might be participatory exercises, it might be consultation, legal documents. So the most common is legal documents. Schooling is, until 1954, schooling was compulsory through primary education. From 1954 to 1989, it was compulsory until 8th grade, and now it's compulsory until 10th class. So you might have different cohorts, and you might set your deprivation cohorts to meet the legal requirements. Or you might have a national plan, and the national plan is to provide universal access to antenatal care for women. And so you know that the target is 100%. So any deprivation, and it's a 0-1, have you had antenatal care? Any deprivation matters. So you can use the National Development Plan, as Colombia did, to set the deprivation cutoffs. So when you justify them, you can draw on some of now these very now familiar documents that you'll have considered in measurement design. Finally, of course, you will need to look at robustness of these as well. A moment to relax and go to Bhutan to a participatory exercise. We've been talking about them. How many people have done participatory work? Okay, a number, but by no means all. So this was work with the National Statistics Bureau, and the field studies were designed to give input into the draft national multidimensional poverty measure that Mojica will present. And at that time, it was being designed by the NSB, and Tashi Namge, pictured standing, is from the NSB. In the participants first identified the dimensions of poverty. They were asked, and in that society, it was culturally acceptable to ask with men and women present, and to ask with all members of the community or the hamlet, it was a very small hamlet, of different socioeconomic classes together. Sometimes you have to ask with them separately. They then ranked the dimensions of poverty to give us some idea of their priority, and they did this as a community. And then they identified, in a sense, how much was enough, or in each of the different indicators, what the deprivation cutoff should be. Then overnight, we implemented with them the trial measure, then under consideration in the capital city, and in the morning presented the results, and they told us why we were wrong and how to improve. So it's a very, very useful study. So for example, in Dungna, here pictured, they came up with six dimensions of poverty: a lack of land, children not being able to study, not having a livelihood, dependency ratio, food insecurity, and domestic violence. And they articulated and defined each of those. And then they set cutoffs for each of them, how much land was enough. And what's interesting is that they could do this. They said, here in this region, given our land quality, to 3 to 5 acres is enough. But in Punaha, you don't need so much because it's very good land. And in some places, you need more. Children's education was astonishing. They wanted their children to be educated to class 13 or higher. They didn't quite know the dependency ratio. They just knew that some families had many benefits, but had too many elders and young children to be able to make ends meet. They could set a very clear income poverty line, and also food security, but domestic violence was difficult to set a cutoff for. They spoke about the trend. And then they also did a ranking. They ranked the dimensions into three categories: the most important ones, the middle ones, and the less important ones. And this was when they did the rankings. And then we did the community, and we gave one page to each person in the community and ranked them according to the measures. And then we were able to collect their insights back into the NSB's trial measure. For example, the NSB were using the Millennium Development definitions of adequate sanitation, in which a protected latrine is required for adequate sanitation. The convention is to have an unprotected latrine, but it's a relatively cold climate, it's high in the mountains, and they said, that's good enough for us. We don't need anything better. They had put in three livestock, three cows, But it's very different if you have a Jersey cow, which gives a lot more milk than a different brand of cow. So this, again, is telling NSB, next time you do a survey, get something about the cows, not just their number, because everybody has a cow. And there was another community that also did this and came up, and this is what I wanted to share with you. This community was maybe 6 hours away, so not so far. 6 hours of a drive plus a four-hour walk. But they had quite different priorities. Neither community had electricity, but for this community, it was the number one priority. And in Dungna, which did not have electricity, it didn't come up as a priority. But Dungna knew that they were going to get electricity within 6 months. So you see some differences. So although it was a deprivation, because of their expectations, they didn't name it. Sanitation was named in Rupiesa as a deprivation. So these are quite useful, both because of the diversity of things that come out, but also because of the times in which you recognize shortcomings of your existing measures. Okay, end of our digression. Only two left, and the last one's easy. So we are now down to weights. Maybe at another time, I'll go a little bit more into weights. I want you to understand one thing, which many experts who criticized the M0 or MPI when we first put it out did not understand, which is that the weights on the MPI are very different from weights on, for example, the Human Development Index or the Composite Index. And that is because the MPI has 0-1 deprivation matrix behind it. If you use an HDI, then the weights govern if my life expectancy goes from 49 to 49.5, how much does the HDI change? Or if my income goes from 30,000 to 30,500, how much does the HDI change? It also governs the marginal rate of substitutability across dimensions. If my life expectancy goes from 49 to 49.5, and I see the change in HDI, what change in income would create the same change as that increase in life expectancy, right? And these are quite complicated decisions to make, and I, as I said, very much agree with the concerns that Martin Ravalian has raised about how to make those choices in a cardinal composite well-being index. But the MPI applies weights to the 0-1 deprivation matrix. And so they only cover whether or not you turn on or turn off a deprivation. So they're much easier and more transparent to set. And that's important. I've just said it. But if you have questions, please do come, because it's important to understand and distinguish from others. Now, let's make a very basic point. Back to you. In evaluating the summer school, how do we weight? I'm going to ask you to vote on what you think is the most important. The expansion in understanding stochastic dominance, understanding the capability approach, completion of your paper and STATA exercises, your collegial relationships, the ability to complete your own research, your understanding of British poverty, your future earning potential over 20 years, and your satisfaction with life as a whole. So these are the eight dimensions of our summer school well-being. Which of them is most important? So who votes for one? Who votes for two? Wow, quite a number. Who votes for three? Buba, you're counting. A few maybes, okay. Who votes for four? Yay, you're gonna plan our dinners. Who votes for five? Okay, who votes for six? Very tentative, are you on or off? Five, okay. How about seven? And how about eight? Wow, so everyone had a vote except for one or six. So, yeah? We are saying which of these would have the highest weight.
What do you mean by British poverty?
British poverty.
Does it have a special...
I don't know. Have we been taught British poverty? We're in Britain. So if you were interested in understanding social exclusion in Britain or child poverty in Britain, the debates that are very strong here, actually, how well has your summer school expanded your capability in that?
Sorry, I thought something special.
Okay, so the bottom line from that is that you and I and one another, we have different views of what weights are. Our weightings are plural, right? So that's a basic point. In any society, it's very unlikely that all hands go up for the same indicator, even if we've had a common experience. So given the fact that weights are plural, and if I did it tomorrow, we might have different ones, there are some features to think about. And I think I have these in the wrong order. I don't have the right thing. So Sen also has a statement, which is later, which is that we don't need a referendum on weights, but we do need to really consult different sectors and understand the diversity of values people have. He also argues, and this is a value of the MPI, that we should make the weights very explicit. How many of you know the prices that are imputed to subsistent commodities in your poverty line? A couple. Yeah, so the MPI does make very explicit. You know the weight which is on each of the dimensions. It's there, it's in the papers. You disagree with it, you can criticize it, you can change it, you can robustify it. But at least the weights are transparent. And that's quite an important thing to try to do, is to make your calibrations and your parameter decisions transparent. And I think beyond that, the weights debate, which was quite strong in 2010, has clarified a few different things. I mentioned yesterday, one, that the weights are normative. We just saw that we will disagree. And because we will disagree, any measure that comes out of our summer school well-being has to be robust to a range of weights, because we will not agree. And so if there's a measure that only looks at the capability approach as being the number one, the most important dimension, then for a number of us we'll say it's not legitimate, I don't believe it. And so we have to make measures that reflect plural weights. And therefore we have to do robustness tests for the relevant policy prescriptions, test them, it's a ranking, it's composition of poverty, however the information is used, test them for a range of weights. And then, as we've mentioned, weights are a function of the deprivation cutoffs, and what we'll look at tomorrow, they're also influenced by the association across indicators. So the most common approach in practice is to set equal weights across dimensions and equal weights across indicators within dimensions. That's what, for example, the global MPI did, or what Mexico, in a sense, has done. However, sometimes we, in presentations, we say it's non-weighting, or I didn't know how to weight them, so I didn't weight them. But is that the case? I'd like you, we'll run a little bit into coffee, but I'll give you a half an hour coffee break and take a bit of time away from the next session. I'd like you to just take a couple minutes to look at this problem. You have one measure with two dimensions, body mass index and years of schooling. You've equally weighted them at 0.5. You have another measure with four indicators, body mass index, years of schooling, caloric intake, and anemia, each weighted at 0.25. What is the weight on health versus education in each example? 0.5. Right. So the number of indicators, if they're equally weighted, is bigger in health in the second measure. So equal weighting means you really do have to look. This is why we bring in dimensions, but it also may be why you would have to look at whether each indicator within a dimension is of equal importance. I'm going to leave these slides with you, I think, end on this. And then we'll get to how, in addition, you can set weights. So in terms of the normative criteria, Sen first asks, how are the weights going to be selected? And he says, for a person, It might require your own reflection, which of these dimensions of my summer school is most important. But you and I are doing weights for poverty measures, which are social evaluations. As you said, we need to think for the society. And so there may need to be consensus on a range of weights. There won't be consensus on a particular set of weights. And so there is a need for public discussion, which could be in the media, rather than participatory exercises, and a democratic understanding and acceptance. So now we have the task clear. We need to set weights, and we need to somehow have it have a legitimacy for society. And how do we do it? The example is very like the group of mice. So all of us are mice, and we've decided to bell the cat. And the cat is the one that we really need to watch and follow. And so we say, okay, we've made this decision. Who's going to bell the cat? Right? You remember the fairy tale. So how are we going to set the weights? Is it through survey data? Is it through participatory methods, experts, or some combination? I'm going to give you a couple examples. One we've already discussed and seen, it's focus groups. They name, they rank the most important aspects of deprivation or ill-being. And you take this ordinal ranking and convert it into cardinal weights and do different conversions and test them. But you basically use the participatory measures, methods, with very clear input that has to be self-critically implemented to create weights. A second approach is to use survey data. And in this approach, you could actually put questions into your survey that'll help you. So this is the Socially Perceived Necessities Survey that came out of Bristol in the UK. It was also used in different places. This is from South Africa's survey that Gemma Wright implemented. And so she asked, is this item, she was looking at different items like electricity or household goods, essential for everybody to have in order to enjoy an acceptable standard of living in South Africa today? And they looked at the percentage of people saying yes. So 50% meant that that item got a weight of 50%. 92% meant that that item got a weight of 92%. So the percentage of people who defined it as essential for everyone in South Africa today was the weight they put on the indicator. That's one option using survey data. There were also follow-up questions. For example, do you have an item? And if not, why not? Because you don't want it or because you can't afford it. You don't have the capability to enjoy it. So there are lots of different ways. Those are just a few of the ways of setting weights. But the point is that there is no perfect way of setting weights. But you're safe, in a sense, by using multiple sources and by doing the robustness tests. And this messy arrangement, as Sen says, is actually the best that we have because there is no magic formula that would give us ready-made weights that are just right. So maybe a disappointing outcome, but it perhaps is important to look at. Now you will be tempted then to run to statistics to find an answer and to do statistical weights. And we'll talk a little bit more at different times about the pros and the cons of using statistical weights. But again, we went speaking a bit yesterday about the principal component analysis weights. The challenge there is really to justify them when people want to understand the decisions you're making. So the last of your eight choices is the poverty cutoff. And the good news is that you run a loop and you do lots of poverty cutoffs and you do robustness. But you need to know that the politicians are more interested in the poverty cutoff than anything else because it sets the headcount ratio that the journalists report. So you need to be up to speed in terms of how you set your poverty cutoff, the public one that you will use when you decompose by regions and when you present the final measure. What is the poverty cutoff? It identifies each person as poor or non-poor according to the count vector, the CI vector, the sum of weighted deprivations that they experience. And in so doing, it provides the minimum eligibility criteria for poverty, and it reflects a judgment of who is poor. And because the cross-dimensional setting of K is not necessarily very familiar, there are different ways that it has been set in practice. Bhutan set it to match the headcount ratio in the first period in which they were implementing their national MPI. Mexico set it using an axiomatic justification and to match a legal definition. And others set them in other ways. I will leave Ana to present how Colombia justified it and Gisela to present how Mexico justified it. So the final observation, and this is quite important for you because we observed in this summer school, both last year and in March when we taught it, that students didn't quite get this point because your loop was chunky and didn't match your weights. So I'd like to point something out to you, a little key, a tip for extra credit. You can set a poverty cutoff, but the key to communicate it is to communicate it in a way that people will understand. You're deprived in one third of the dimensions, means two education or health indicators, six living standard indicators, or three living standard indicators and any health or education indicator. That's the way people are going to understand the poverty cutoff when you communicate it. Now, I have a problem for you, and you need to think, last time you have to think here. You have an equally weighted measure with five indicators. Each one weights 20%. Your poverty cutoff is 21%. Or 25%. Or 33%. Or 40%. Which of these will best communicate what poverty is? First of all, will the same number of people be identified as poor by each of these poverty cutoffs or not? No? Think it through. Yeah, Paola?
I think yes, but I think the thing is they will have different deprivations, but they will still be poor.
Mm-hmm.
The same amount, the proportion will still be the same.
Okay.
1, 25, 33, or 40, but the deprivations will be different.
Will they? So, yeah, somebody new, so yourself. Yeah.
And 40 is
with
K equal to 2.
Okay. So just think with me. I have a population, and let's say 90% of people are deprived in one dimension or more.
21%.
Okay. So if you have a K between 0 and 20%, right, you get 90% as your headcount. And then I jump, because every dimension is equally weighted at 20%. So then I jump, and 70% of people are deprived in two or more deprivations. So if I have a K of 21%, how many people are poor? 70%. K of 25%, how many people are poor? 70%. K of 33%? 70%. K of 40%? 70%. So the K from anywhere from 21 to 40, any cardinal value of K, will identify the same people and they'll have the same intensity. It's a very simple world because they are all equally weighted. So you basically have a step of deprivations, 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5. In that context, as you said, the simplest is to say they're deprived in 2 out of 5 deprivations, 2 out of 5, 40%. But what people might do, because they did it last year in the summer school, is they said 21% or 25%. But it doesn't have an intuition. So when you communicate the poverty cutoff, it's quite important to communicate it in the simplest possible way, given the weights of the indicators that you have. So change your loop file. Yes?
But I think also we learned that the poverty cutoffs might be different from the deprivation levels.
Mm-hmm.
The poverty cutoffs could be determined, said maybe one deprivation, or two, or three, or four.
Mm-hmm.
It can be really predetermined.
Mm-hmm.
So the cutoff for the poverty is different from the number of deprivation. They might not be the same,
mm-hmm.
really. Yeah. Okay.
That's correct, yeah. And so clearly you will justify K in different ways, and You'll see some examples of it in what follows the tea break. So that's where we've gotten to. We've gone through 8 steps, quite a lot. It's a bit of a mind-boggling amount of material. So are there any burning questions, or shall we break for tea and just ask individual questions? Yep.
Okay, thank you very much. I have 2 questions, and you have touched a little bit on indicators, and I think we'll be covering it more in the future, but I want to get clear with the indicators. When we do the union approach, we usually have relative prices for each of our indicators. But in terms of this, how do we define the relative prices of, let's say, school enrollment? Because at the end, unlike other measures, this is something that comes from micro level and being aggregated to the national. So we're going to have household level data, and how do we have relative prices for each households in terms of schooling so that we aggregate it and define the deprivation. Another issue is when it comes to ACES, when we define the deprivation, again, we're going to be defining it in terms of regions and across the household characteristics, because people living in the urban and people living in the rural areas, they will have different deprivations. So how do we deal with that ones?
Yeah. So in terms of the first question, in terms of relative prices, what the function that prices play in an income poverty measure, the weights play in a multidimensional poverty measure. Okay, so the weight vector is fixed across the population. You could technically give everybody their own values. If you had, for example, a survey with their own subjective values on each of the dimensions, you could technically do it, but you would affect the properties because you would not be able to decompose by dimension and interpret the raw, the uncensored and censored headcounts in the same way. So what we usually do is have the fixed weighting vector. And so instead of relative prices, you say we have a weight of 1/18 on electricity. And those then are set, as I've said, in the ways that we set weights. In terms of the second question of rural and urban, that's a very good question. And we released a study this year comparing MPI for urban and rural areas. And the indicators that we used are the same across rural and urban areas. And that was a deliberate decision of UNDP when we constructed the measure, is to start simple. But there is a question of whether to add, for example, in urban areas, things like overcrowding or crime, and whether to add in rural areas things like livestock or land or different kinds of assets like wagons or boats. So there are certain ways that you could have distinctive national, rural and urban measures, and there are groups pursuing those. So in a sense, it would be a decision to be taken. Either you have the same measure, which is what at the moment, for example, Mexico and Colombia have, or as in an income poverty measure, you could have different rural and urban measures, because that's always done in consumption poverty with the different prices.